Hi, I'm Dr. Rajani, and I am so excited I'm getting a treatment today. I'm getting Ulthera, or Micro Focused Ultrasound, full face and neck. I'm taking you with me, and as I get the procedure, we're going to be answering the most asked questions and dangers, and does it work? Can it fail? Now, a lot of people do RF, so radio type of frequency, RF microneedling, needles that go in and heat, HIFU, high intensity focus ultrasound. We're going to go through the differences today a little bit, but everything we're talking about can in some way apply to all of those. A lot of people feel like they're gonna lose facial fat. I'm even going to treat under the eye to show you what we do to avoid fat loss under there. So a very important video. The most common questions we're going to answer for you: do you lose fat in the face? Does it work? Does everyone get results? Why don't they get results? Is it painful? Real time, you'll see what pain control measures I'm going to use. And finally, how often should you do it? Now, I'm going to get it done by Kelly Conover of Conover Aesthetics in South Carolina. She's done thousands, but she's also read the data, and she'll answer the questions from a scientific point of view. Am I gonna lose that fat? Stay tuned and we'll find out. Now first, get your Rajani cup, sit down. We're going into her clinic. Before we get started, click the like button and subscribe. Okay, I'm here with Kelly Conover of Conover Aesthetics.
Hi.
And I'm getting my Ulthera done. So I'm doing this because viewers are very concerned about fat loss. And I'm gonna go through the top three or four questions you guys have asked me about Ulthera and high frequency ultrasound. Now, first of all, there's a little bit of pain, but it's very, very tolerable. I would say a little less than RF microneedling that I would do, but there are many different RF microneedlings out there. So the number one question, and Kelly and I have already talked, and I agree with her answers. And primarily, I wouldn't be doing this if I was going to lose face fat. So I'll answer the questions and then I'm gonna show you the ultrasound screen and she'll talk a little bit about what she's looking at. This is something you don't want just anyone doing. In my opinion, there's only a few people in the country who are great at doing this procedure. So of course, the person performing it is very, very important. So the first question is, Kelly, you can answer, do you lose facial fat? And what do we say to those people who say they've lost facial fat from Ulthera?
Well, I wish it were that easy is what I would say. If we could really remove enough facial fat for them to notice from the singular Ultherapy treatment, we'd have people lined up from here to Colombia, the country, to be seen. In the clinical studies, there was a trivial amount of fat reduction, but it's the amount of one singular, as in one singular English pea. And that was over the entire face and neck. So you couldn't even see it with the human eye. So there is no issue.
It's contraction of tissue.
Correct.
Right? Yep. It's contraction of tissue that,
like Spanx,
that is creating the perception of volume loss. But at the end of the day, if that loose skin is sitting there and creating volume, that's not a good look either. I'd rather have the tissue contracted, and then we can add PRF or Sculptor back to add that volume. So to me, if you have someone who knows what they're doing, I have zero worry about losing facial fat, to be quite frank. Okay, number two question everyone's gonna ask, does it work? And I hate this one because I could have person A over there do it. It ain't gonna work. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's not gonna work. What you're doing to me, or can you tell a little bit about, I might be different from the other patients, of course, my skin might be different. What are you looking at, or what do you adjust to get my result? Because it's ultimately, I'm just worried about my result, and you have different people coming in. What do you think the number one or two, three things to get a result is?
Well, first you have to have the proper candidate, right? So I treat plenty of patients who really are facelift candidates, and we recommend that they do that first. You know, you think about it, when you're working with minimally and non-invasive technology, you're seeing change in like millimeters, like tiny, tiny change.
Yes.
So proper candidate to start with, someone who doesn't have a ton.
Am I a good candidate?
You're a great candidate.
Thank goodness.
And the reason you're a good candidate,
she's not sending me for a facelift yet.
No, okay. You don't have enough to cut and tuck, but okay. The advantage of you is you have so much collagen naturally. You've really maintained your skin over the years.
Can you show them how you know that?
Yeah.
Okay. This is really key for these people, for people to understand that you can see things before you hit me with energy.
Exactly. So okay. We want to make sure that we're delivering the energy to the proper layers in your skin. We're targeting two key areas. The first is your deep dermal layer, or your SMAS is what we call that. And let me image here. Of course, because you're videoing, my image is going to be blurry. Can you see the two little parallel lines down at this 4-5 mark on the screen? It's right below where the green line is.
Okay, so you can see that,
yes.
The green line.
So,
okay.
Underneath the green line is the SMAS, and it just looks like two little parallel lines that run underneath there. So that's the first layer that I'm targeting, which I just completed. I did that with the 4.5 transducer. The second thing I'm targeting is the deep dermal layer. And you notice his deep dermal layer, you see how it's really wide up top, up to about the 1.5 millimeter mark? That is his dermis, and it's super thick and juicy and exactly what we want to see. So I'm actually going to do a bit of each transducer on him, 4.5, 3.0, and 1.5, and I'll just tweak it based on the area of his face.
I think people don't understand how complex it is, and they're like, oh, what device should I use? It's the number one question. Should I get this device or this device? If you have someone with a good device, it's the provider.
For sure.
I mean, especially with something like this.
And I've done thousands of these at this point. So it just becomes second nature. You know what you're looking at on the screen. But you know, there's lots of great technology. I'm not saying this is the only option out there, but
well, it's interesting though. You see people who have one Ulthera, they often buy several because they know how to use it.
Right.
Okay, the next most common question I get asked, and I want a result walking out of here today, but that's not always possible. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the treatments I do, they see results over months. When am I going to see a result? And how do you walk through people the fact that, hey, it's not like getting lip filler, we're going to walk in today and 20 minutes later you have lips. What do you tell them?
Yeah, so you really just identified the biggest drawback of Ulthera. You know, when patients lay here for an hour and a half, they've dealt with some degree of pain or whatever, they're expecting a result immediately, and that's just not the case. We have to give the collagen time to remodel. So all we're doing is just stimulating his collagen and elastin. And we're involving his body in the process of working with us. So timeline, when we're done, I'm gonna show you this side of your face. So your right side compared to the left side, you're going to already see some change.
Okay.
That's not your result. That's just like the happy contraction that happens initially. You're really looking at about 2 months.
Okay.
We tell patients 3 to 6 months. I'd say the vast majority of mine are already noticing something at the 2 to 3 month mark.
I think the best practices that I walk into are able to tell patients, hey, your result I'm worried about over years and years, mm-hmm. not today, tomorrow, in a week.
Correct.
I mean, to be able to have a patient base that understands they want to look the same today as they look 10 years from now. I think that's a goal.
Right, absolutely.
To not age, at least in outward.
Mm-hmm.
But not everyone can do that.
Right.
A lot of people have trouble telling the clients, hey, you're not going to go on Instagram tonight and see your results.
Exactly, but it is a foundation level treatment.
It's the most important thing.
Right.
And that's on my channel. I'm always telling people the most important thing is results over time, mm-hmm. and patience.
Right.
And I think you have that. There are things we can do for instant result, and that's great. But I'm going to do this, what, every year?
You know, it's interesting. When the clinical studies were first done, they were telling patients about every 2 to 3 years. And, you know, they did them, the recommended age is age 30 to 60. And when we first started doing it back in 2015, we were following that guidance. And I tell you, after doing so many of them, the vast majority of patients that do this treatment and love it and come back, they're doing it about once a year.
Yeah.
You know, once you're in your late 50s, early 60s, you can do it every 6 months, and that's safely. You
yes.
know, so it's very safe to do
so
it.
So for me, I'll be like every 3 months. A high maintenance guy like myself, aging rate,
There's no reason to do it. Yeah, there's no reason to do it that much, because remember, you're going to continue to see improvements up to 6 months.
Right.
So we don't need to
treat it. And I can do my sculptor with this, no problem.
Oh my gosh. Not only can you, but you should. That's like the double whammy. You know, some practices, they call it, what is the skull therapy?
Yeah.
That's just marketing. Yeah, but it's sculpture and all therapy combined.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's good, because combinations are always the best. Mm-hmm. In terms of pain, I can tell you there's the odd zinger, but for a result, I mean, nothing.
Yeah.
Close to nothing. There's the odd one, but I expected much more pain. Do you think the procedure has changed over the years? Why does everyone say it's the most painful thing they've done? Why?
Well, so the device came out, I think it was 2009, and they were having to do nerve blocks to get patients through it. So, you know, I've got a number of celebrity clients that say, hey, I've hired my own anesthesiologist just to do that treatment.
Exactly.
Ridiculous.
Yeah.
And it's so interesting, because then I have treated them after that time, and I've done it, and they're like, are you sure you're doing it correctly? There is no pain. It's because providers do not know how to read an ultrasound. And if you are delivering the energy to the wrong part of the skin, not only are you not getting them a result, the energy is useless there, but it's also hurting really bad.
Yes.
So your question was whether the technology changed. So yes, when it first came out, they weren't selling a lot of treatments because it was so painful.
Yeah.
In 2015, they resubmitted to the FDA, and don't quote me on dates, but they came out with the Amplify protocol, and that's what we're using today.
Okay.
So the Amplify protocol, it takes longer to do, mm-hmm. so lots of providers don't want to deal with that. But for me, it's more lines of energy, but the joules are lower, so that, you know, patients can get through it a whole lot easier.
Makes a lot of sense.
I told you I've done thousands. I've never, ever, ever had a patient say, time out, I'm done, ever.
Yeah.
And so that to me is data.
Yeah. No, I mean, and I can tell you that it's very comfortable.
So all of these heating devices that work in somewhat different ways but similar help denature the proteins, build collagen, tighten the skin, and they're part of your skincare routine. I put a complete video up here on your skincare routine, things you can do at home, keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.